In this lecture, we are going to cover the pharmacology of antiviral drugs, so let's get right into it. Antivirals are a large and diverse group of agents that are typically classified by the virus infections for which they are used. For simplicity, we can divide them into four groups, that is, number 1, anti-influenza drugs, number 2, anti-HIV drugs, number 3, anti-hepatitis drugs, and number 4, anti-herpes drugs. Now, let's discuss these one by one, starting with anti-influenza drugs. So, influenza is an enveloped virus with a genome made up of single-stranded segmented RNA. The viral envelope is made up of a lipid bilayer that contains three of the viral transmembrane proteins, hemagglutinin, neuraminidase, and matrix 2, abbreviated as M2. The first step of the influenza virus infection involves binding of hemagglutinin to sialic acid residues on the surface of host cell, which results in engulfment of the virus into the cell via endocytosis. Next, the membrane protein M2 forms pH-gated channels that allow protons to move through the viral envelope and acidify the core of the virus, causing release of the viral RNAs and proteins, which are then transported into the cell nucleus. In the nucleus, viral RNA is transcribed into messenger RNA. The translation of mRNA into viral proteins takes place in ribosomes in the cytoplasm. Once synthesized, hemagglutinin and neuraminidase glycoproteins are secreted through the Golgi apparatus onto the cell surface, where they fuse with the plasma membrane, whereas other viral proteins migrate back to the nucleus, where they assemble with newly replicated genomes. Assembled viral capsid then moves to the plasma membrane, where it buds off, taking a segment of membrane containing the hemagglutinin and neuraminidase, and thus forming a viral particle. In the last step of the replication, viral neuraminidase enzyme cleaves and removes sialic acid receptors from the surface of the cell, thereby allowing release and spread of the virus to new cells. Now, there are three classes of approved drugs for influenza. The first one are M2 ion channel inhibitors, which work simply by blocking the M2 channel and thereby restricting passage of protons, which are required to trigger the release of viral genes into the host cell. Drugs that belong to this class include amantadine and rimantadine. Now, moving on to the next class, which actually represents a new class of anti-influenza agents called endonuclease inhibitors. At this time, the only agent in this class is a drug called Baloxavir, which works by selectively inhibiting CAP-dependent endonuclease, a key enzyme involved in the initiation of influenza virus mRNA synthesis. By blocking this enzyme, Baloxavir prevents viral gene transcription and ultimately influenza virus replication. Finally, moving on to the third class of influenza drugs, that is neuraminidase inhibitors. The agents in this class exert their antiviral activity by inhibiting the viral neuraminidase enzyme found on the surface of the viral particle. Without active neuraminidase, the virus is unable to cleave sialic acid and unable to escape from the cell. Drugs that belong to this class include Oseltamivir, Peramivir, and Zanamivir. Now let's move on to our next group of antivirals, that is anti-HIV drugs. So HIV, or human immunodeficiency virus, is composed of three main layers: the envelope containing surface proteins GP120 and GP41, the viral matrix containing protease enzymes, and the core containing viral capsid encasing two copies of RNA and enzymes such as reverse transcriptase and integrase. The main target of HIV is the CD4 positive T lymphocytes, which are essential regulators of the immune system. The first step of HIV infection involves sequential binding of the GP120, first to CD4 receptor, and then to human coreceptor, either CCR5 or CXCR4. This binding enables the viral envelope to fuse with the host cell membrane, allowing viral capsid to enter the host cell cytoplasm. During encoding, the single-stranded RNA genomes within the capsid are released into the cytoplasm, where the enzyme reverse transcriptase converts the virus RNA into double-stranded DNA. Next, the integrase enzyme binds to the viral DNA, transports it into the nucleus, and inserts it into the host cell's DNA. Using the host cellular system, copies of HIV genomic RNA as well as shorter strands of messenger RNA are constructed and then transported out of the nucleus. In the cytoplasm, mRNA is translated by the host cell's ribosome to viral proteins that undergo modification and cleavage by HIV protease enzymes. Finally, the resulting structural proteins and replication enzymes assemble with viral genomic RNA to form new variants, which then bud off of the host cell, thus creating new viruses capable of infecting other cells. Now, there are several classes of HIV drugs, each designed to block the virus at specific stage of the replication cycle. So let's discuss these one by one, starting with N3 inhibitors. This class of drugs interferes with the binding, fusion, and entry of an HIV variant to a CD4 cell. Currently, we have three drugs that belong to this class, each with its own unique mechanism of action. The first one, Enfuvirtide, works by binding to the viral protein GP41 and thereby preventing fusion with the CD4 membrane. The second agent, Maraviroc, works by binding to the human chemokine receptor CCR5 and preventing interaction with the viral protein GP120, thereby inhibiting the virus from entering the cell. And lastly, the third agent, Ibalizumab, is a monoclonal antibody that binds to the CD4 receptor and leads to conformational changes that prevent GP120 CD4 complex from interacting with CCR5 or CXCR4, thereby inhibiting viral entry and fusion. Now, moving on to the next class of HIV drugs, that is reverse transcriptase inhibitors. Drugs in this class are divided into competitive and non-competitive inhibitors. Nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors, abbreviated NRTIs, are structural analogs of nucleic acids that competitively inhibit reverse transcription by causing chain termination after they've been incorporated into viral DNA. Drugs that belong to this group include Abacavir, Emtricitabine, Lamivudine, Tenofovir, and Zidovudine. On the other hand, we have non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors, abbreviated NNRTIs, which bind to and denature reverse transcriptase enzyme, thus causing non-competitive inhibition. Drugs that belong to this group include doravirine, efavirenz, etravirine, nevirapine, and rilpivirine. Now, moving on to the next class of HIV drugs, that is integrase inhibitors. This class of drugs prevents HIV from integrating its genetic material into the host cell DNA by specifically blocking the action of the viral integrase enzyme. Drugs in this class include dolutegravir and raltegravir. Finally, moving on to our last class of HIV drugs, that is protease inhibitors. Drugs in this class work by blocking the action of HIV protease enzyme, thus preventing cleavage of viral polyproteins into active proteins that are needed for the assembly of new viral particles. Drugs that belong to this group include atazanavir, darunavir, fosamprenavir, ritonavir, saquinavir, and tipranavir. Now let's move on to our next group of antivirals, that is antihepatitis drugs. There are several types of viruses that primarily attack the liver, with hepatitis B virus and hepatitis C virus being the most common causes of hepatitis for which therapy is currently available. So let's discuss these in more detail, starting with hepatitis B virus. The hepatitis B virus obtains entry into hepatocytes by binding to the receptor called sodium taurocholate cotransporting polypeptide, NTCP for short. In the cytoplasm, the nucleocapsid is encoded at the nuclear membrane and relaxed circular viral DNA is released into the nucleus. Within the nucleus, the relaxed circular DNA is converted into a covalently closed circular double-stranded DNA, which then serves as the template for transcription of the subgenomic and pregenomic RNAs. Next, pregenomic RNA gets translated into viral proteins, including core and polymerase proteins, which then are assembled along with a single strand of pregenomic RNA to form nucleocapsid. By using RNA as a template, the negative DNA strand of the viral genome is generated through the process of reverse transcription. The negative DNA strand then serves as the primer for the synthesis of the positive DNA strand. After completion of the positive strand synthesis, the resulting relaxed circular DNA can either be enveloped in endoplasmic reticulum and secreted as progeny variants, or be recycled back to the nucleus for covalently closed circular DNA amplification. The infected cells also secrete hepatitis B core and envelope antigens that promote immune tolerance and persistent infection. Now, all currently approved antiviral drugs for the treatment of chronic hepatitis B virus infection are nucleoside and nucleotide analogs, and include agents such as entecavir, lamivudine, adefovir, telbivudine, and tenofovir. These drugs inhibit multiple functions of the hepatitis B virus polymerase by competing with natural substrates for incorporation into developing viral DNA strand. This results in chain termination and thus inhibition of reverse transcription and synthesis of the viral DNA. Now moving on to hepatitis C virus. So hepatitis C virus enters hepatocytes via receptor-mediated endocytosis. After membrane fusion and uncoating, the positive single-stranded viral RNA is released into the cytosol and then transported to the rough endoplasmic reticulum, where it serves as a template for the viral polyprotein synthesis. Once synthesized, the viral polyprotein is processed by proteases such as NS34A serine protease, which cleaves four non-structural sites to generate the mature proteins that form a complex and initiate replication. Two of these proteins are important targets of anti-hepatitis C drugs: the non-structural protein 5A, which regulates the replication of the hepatitis C viral RNA, and non-structural protein 5B, which serves as the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase that produces negative sense RNA intermediates that are then used to create numerous copies of the positive sense viral RNA. Finally, newly replicated viral RNA is encased between membranes derived from lipid droplets and endoplasmic reticulum, and then released from the infected cell by exocytosis. Now, current hepatitis C treatments are made up of combinations of drugs called direct-acting antivirals that are classified into three groups. The first group includes the inhibitors of NS34A protease. Drugs that belong to this group are boceprevir, glesaprevir, grazoprevir, paritaprevir, cimeprevir, telaprevir, and voxilaprevir. The second group includes the inhibitors of NS5A. Drugs that belong to this group are daclatasvir, elbasvir, ledipasvir, ombitasvir, pibrentasvir, and velpatasvir. And finally, the third group includes the inhibitors of NS5B polymerase. Drugs that belong to this group are dasabuvir and sofosbuvir. Now, before we move on, I wanted to briefly mention one more treatment option for hepatitis, which involves the use of man-made interferons. Interferons are a family of naturally occurring proteins that interfere with the ability of viruses to infect cells by producing an array of antiviral effects, such as blocking viral protein synthesis and inducing viral RNA mutagenesis. By using recombinant DNA techniques and cell tissue cultures, specific interferons can be synthesized to treat hepatitis. Examples are pegylated interferons alpha-2A and alpha-2B. Use of these interferons is often paired with a drug called ribavirin, which enhances their efficacy in treatment of chronic hepatitis C. Now moving on to our last group of antivirals, that is anti-herpes drugs. In order to understand the mechanism of action of these agents, first we need to briefly review the steps of DNA synthesis during replication of herpes virus. So during DNA replication, first nucleosides must be phosphorylated into their active triphosphate form. For example, thymidine is sequentially phosphorylated to monophosphate, diphosphate, and triphosphate, and only then DNA polymerase can incorporate it into the growing chain. Now, the herpes virus has a number of unique enzyme systems to drive these reactions, among them a viral thymidine kinase, which in this example phosphorylates thymidine to yield thymidine monophosphate. In addition to that, this viral thymidine kinase happens to recognize anti-herpes drugs that structurally resemble guanosine nucleoside. These drugs include acyclovir, gencyclovir, and pencyclovir. Specifically, viral thymidine kinase adds a phosphate group to these drug molecules, which then allows other cellular kinases to add two more phosphate groups, thereby producing triphosphate substrates for the viral DNA polymerase enzyme. These triphosphate products then inhibit DNA polymerase by competing with natural nucleotides, or they end up being incorporated into the elongating DNA, leading to chain termination. Other anti-herpes drugs that are commonly used, such as valacyclovir, valganciclovir, and famciclovir are just prodrug forms of the other three designed to improve bioavailability. And with that, I wanted to thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. And as always, stay tuned for more.